Eugene, Oregon. Hudson Stadium, 54,000 strong.
Charles Nelson put on another big pop.
He wants to be on every single play, every single down.
What a strength to fall back on Royce Freeman.
He is a complete back.
He's got the speed. He can run you over, but he's also elusive.
Hogan, underneath, incomplete. And that's it. Oregon holds.
Six straight wins.
What a way to finish off this one.
The Ducks are soaring.
Some people just can't wait. They've been 4 months since they had their fill of football in this town. Others have been waiting a lifetime for their first trip to Eugene, Oregon. It's the 2016 Oregon Spring Game inside Autzen Stadium. The countdown begins today, 125 days till opening day against UC Davis right here at home. Hi, everybody, and welcome to Eugene on a beautiful day. Jim Watson and Glenn Parker. This is the final of all the Pac-12 spring games. For most teams, it's a celebration. It's all over. You get a break. You see old friends. But here in Eugene, they take their football more seriously.
Well, absolutely. They have expectations here. They love their team. This is game atmosphere. Football never sleeps in Autzen Stadium.
It's cold. There's 30,000 people. And before we look ahead, we like to look back. Mixed feelings at the end of last year. It was a successful year. Remember, Vernon Adams, the fifth-year transfer, starts at quarterback against Eastern Washington, his old school. Two touchdowns, good debut. Next week, they're at Michigan State. He throws for 300, but the Spartans win it by three. Oregon splits its first six games, then gets hot, wins six in a row, including the three overtime thriller at Arizona State. They beat Cal, then they go to Stanford and beat the number seven Cardinal, and they earn a berth in the Alamo Bowl against TCU. A 31-0 lead. Dream start turns into a nightmare finish, and TCU comes back to win it. An amazing game. Oregon finishes the season 9-4. So Vernon Adams is gone now. The question is, who starts under center? Is it the fifth-year senior transfer, or is it the redshirt freshman?
When you think Oregon, you think offense. So obviously you have to think about the quarterback position and the players they've had. That is the big question. But they also have to take a look at their offensive line, where they lost three starters, and on defense, where they have had stalwarts the last 3 or 4 years. They only return four starters, so a lot of questions surrounding the Ducks right now.
Offense was awesome last year. The defense had a lot of work to make up, but there are questions like every other team. Four conference titles in the last 6 years. 147 wins since 2000 makes them the Pac-12's winningest program of the century. We come back. Jill Savage with head coach Mark Helfrich, the 2016 Oregon Spring Game.
You're watching Pac-12 Oregon. Home of the Oregon State Beavers and the Oregon Ducks. Available on Xfinity.
The final spring game in the Pac-12 Conference, bridging last year to this year. Remember that Oregon went 9-4. They finished second in the Pac-12 North at 7-2, and it's never surprising to see Oregon in a different kind of uniform, but these aren't new. These are old. They're celebrating the 100th anniversary of Oregon's very first Rose Bowl team. True throwbacks from 1916. It'll be the Oregon Webfoots. That was the original name of this team. They'll be wearing blue against mighty Oregon in the white as we begin 2016 college football on the Pac-12 Network. Jim Watson and Glenn Parker at Autzen Stadium. Jill Savage will be down on the sideline working with us. They're going to have a really nice ceremony here at the beginning, one of the largest American flags you've ever seen, as they incorporate the armed services as they always do in the spring game. They're also encouraging fans to bring canned food into the stadium today. There's no price of admission, but they'd like you to bring in two or three cans of food to help replenish the food banks here in the Eugene area. It's a beautiful day. It's a little cool. They call it partly sunny, but they had rain yesterday. No chance of that today. And a beautiful vantage point from the top of Autzen Stadium. Oregon has always been tough here at home. Last year they lost a couple of times on the home pitch. They're expecting better than 30,000 once again for the spring game. The original colors of the University of Oregon were actually blue and gold with a little white mixed in. Where do they come from? They come from the Oregon state flag. That 1916 team that they're honoring today was 7-0-1. They beat Penn in the Rose Bowl, 1917 Rose Bowl game, 14-0. Big star of that day, Shai Huntington, the very first All-American in Oregon history. And here it comes. I guarantee you this will be the biggest flag you see today, so get out your cameras. Quick shot there of number 9 was Dakota Prukop. He is expected to be the starter under center. And Travis Johnson, the redshirt freshman from down in Southern California right now, slated to be the backup, but that gap has closed. A tribute to the state's armed forces that are serving our country. And participation today includes all branches of the U.S. military. A joint service color guard. And following this game, the players down on the field will present their jerseys to over 100 uniformed men and women. A simple way to say thanks.
Currently serving in the military, we ask that you join us in observing a moment of silence for those who've committed the ultimate sacrifice of life for this country and our freedoms, not able to be with us today. Thank you. Now, as you stand, remove your hats and honor America for the singing of our national anthem, performed today by Senior Airman Keely Speck of the Oregon Air National Guard. Ladies and gentlemen, our national anthem.
Tell you, Glenn, those sights, those sounds, you ready for some football? It feels like fall. I'll tell you, Glenn, those sights, those sounds, you ready for some football? It feels like fall.
It feels like fall, watching the crowd, the weather, and the fact that it's Autzen Stadium. This is the place.
This is an amazing venue during season and even in spring with 30,000 and all this military. and they are celebrating the 100th anniversary of Oregon's first Rose Bowl team. That's why the colors will be blue and gold with white today. By the way, that 1917 Rose Bowl team was coached by Hugh Bezdek, and what was he remembered for? He introduced the forward pass here at Oregon.
How about that?
It's done pretty well since then, huh?
They've had a lot of good passers come through the Duck program.
Remember that last year this offense scored 43 points a game, but they were evenly balanced. We'll see what Mark Helfrich has in store for us today. He's down on the field with our Jill Savage.
Thank you so much, Coach Helfrich. Obviously, the Military Appreciation Day, year after year, Oregon does it. Why does it mean so much to be able to give back?
Well, I mean, it's a simple, easy way to make a bold statement. From a personal standpoint, there are so many guys with connections. My dad went to school here, played football, was in the military. My uncle played football here, was in the military. And then, you know, everybody deserves to or needs to say thank you to the servicemen and women every day of the year. And we just pick a couple.
I'm sure it's the first time you've been asked about the quarterbacks all spring long. I won't ask you to pick a starter for us, but what are you looking at? How have they progressed throughout spring?
They progressed really well. Today's going to be a little bit perhaps shoddy with our execution of having mixed teams. You know, it's not ones, twos, or ones, twos, threes, or anything. And so that can lead to a little bit of slop. But just wanted to play fast, play with confidence, and they've done that this spring.
And outside of that position group, what are you looking for overall here?
Just to play fast, you know, play cleanly. We'd like to play cleanly in every phase, tackle well, run hard, and put on a little show and stay healthy.
You look at the new coaches that you brought in, Brady Hoke, everybody who's talking about the jolt of energy, and then David Yost, obviously, working with those quarterbacks. What have those two added to this coaching staff?
They've been big. I think they're great people, first and foremost, and so that's something that you know, shines through. And then Brady kind of has that perfect balance of old school and drill sergeant with putting his arm around people and loving them. And then Yost, he's kind of he's got the look of the surf dude, but extremely intelligent guy and a great coach.
All right, your team's taking the field. Thanks for your time. We'll see you soon.
All right, take care.
Could be the only surf dude in Eugene today.
I don't know about that.
David Yost. Yeah, well, you're a big surfer. That's right. All right, here's the format today. There are two separate teams, but as Mark just told you, they didn't divide them up between first team and second team. 12-minute clock in the first half, and in the second half, we'll go with a running clock. First play of the spring, and, of course, everybody came out today to see these two quarterbacks because that's kind of what the big question is coming in. Johnny Munt makes that first catch. And the first quarterback you see today is actually Travis Johnson. Now, Johnson, redshirt freshman, Servite High School down in Southern California, go Friars. And he's been pushing Prukop during spring. Competition is good at all positions. Is it good at quarterback?
Well, I think at this time in spring, it's great. If you're looking for a starter, you want him to compete. You want a guy who wants to step up. You want a guy that wants to be the guy. Last thing you need is a quarterback that's a little bit afraid of competition.
Yeah, Helfrich even told us that Travis Johnson had the upper hand early in camp because he'd been here longer than Dakota Prukop, and so he said he just understood the system a little bit better. Travis was injured last year, had the red shirt, and spent countless hours throwing into a net, but, you know, you can work on your arm strength, you can work on your delivery, but timing has to be honed out here on the field. He's got to reestablish himself now in the rotation. Right, Farrell Brown with a catch, and the crowd goes crazy. Remember, Farrell Brown was out last year, and listen to that hand. They're happy to see him.
First thing you notice with Oregon right away, it's tempo. They're very up-tempo. They're not taking it easy because it's spring. They want to see what quarterback commands the offense, gets them up to the line fast, gets things moving.
It's Darren Carrington. Carrington really came on at the end of last year, 7 games, 600 yards, 6 touchdowns. Let's go down to Jill.
That Farrell Brown got, that he's been cleared to play, obviously. He said it's remarkable that he's even out there. And the UO sports science people are tracking his output in practice so he doesn't overdo it. He has a GPS system that goes live to an app on a phone, so they know if he's going to be taking too many hits or whatnot. So Farrell Brown, they've been making sure he's been okay to play all spring long, and he said it was his goal to get back out here on the field for the spring game. He hasn't played in Autzen Stadium since November 11th, 2014, Jim.
Yeah, and for a guy of his age, Jill, that's almost 2 years. I mean, that's just got to be an eternity, especially because he's around the program all the time. He sees everybody. and he's been playing football since he could walk, and all of a sudden it's taken away. So it's got to be tough. Handoff is Tony Brooks James. You know about the guys in the backfield, Taj Griffin. Tony Brooks James will be on this side. In the white today will be Kenai Benoit, and of course Royce Freeman, who was phenomenal last year. We'll talk more about him when he gets a touch. Travis Johnson is marching the Oregon Webfoots. That's the blue team today. And Mighty Oregon on the other side, bobbling catch and made. Johnny Munt. Well, everybody talks about Farrell Brown at tight end, but they say they're going to go two tight ends. And how about Johnny Munt on the other side?
Well, Johnny Munt's been a productive player in the Duck system for a while now. And he's a guy that gives you a lot if you're a quarterback as far as that safety net. Now you bring Farrell Brown, now you got a guy who can stretch and do some more things for me. Two tight end sets, going to be great for them.
Both of those guys are seniors. Reggie Daniels with the interception and the return. So, of course, the crowd groans because Travis Johnson could see a lot of time under center, and he throws an interception to cap off his first drive. They were moving until this throw. Late across the middle, never a good idea.
Yeah, and there were a couple of throws that were close early, but he put them where they had to be, and that's the first throw that he just shouldn't have made. The other ones were close, but he made them. This one, he should never have let the ball go.
You know, it looks like he thought an awful lot, and Mark Helfrich and, of course, Matt Lubeck, the offensive coordinator, they'll tell you, hey, you can't really think in our offense. It's got to be instincts. It's got to be feel. You got to go. In fact, Helfrich said something to us during our call that I think should be on a T-shirt up here. He said, we go fast. And that's really the explanation. The spread offense, the spread formation is you never have time to breathe if you're playing against it.
I thought that was Ricky Bobby in Talladega Nights that said that. But apparently it was Mark Helfrich in the Ducks. But, you know, you're right. They go fast. And the best way I can say it, and it's Coach Rich Rodriguez, Arizona, says it. Helfrich says it. I believe Chip Kelly actually said it at one point, too. A quarterback in this system is more like a point guard. He's running the offense and dishing the assist based on what the defense does while in motion as opposed to pre-snap reads. And you know, if you think about it that way, it's a very different way of looking at the quarterback position than the traditional read the defense, understand where they're going to be, make your progressions. You can't be thinking too much in this offense at quarterback. You have to kind of feel it.
Charles Nelson took that first toss from Dakota Prukop. Originally from Austin, Texas, and remember he spent a couple of seasons in Bozeman at Montana State as the starter. Threw for over 3,000 yards. Tall and confident in the pocket, dumps it off when everything else broke down. Royce Freeman, his first touch. What about Royce Freeman? They think they have, and this is according to Matt Lubeck, he says, I don't think we have the best back in the Pac-12. I think we have the best back in the country. Is he that good?
Oh, I think he's that good. And he, as a freshman, when you saw this kid, there was something immediately different about him. And all he's done is gone out on the field and proven how good he is over the last couple of years. He's a guy that when you talk to other coaches that were recruiting him, they all thought he was the best back they had seen in high school. And everybody wanted this kid, but he'd come down, he got injured in high school, so he wasn't as heavily recruited towards the end. As you look at the rushing yard game from last season, McCaffrey and Freeman there in the Pac-12.
You mentioned Freeman's rookie campaign back in 2014 when he became the first Oregon true freshman to rush for 1,000 yards. He comes back last year and sets the Oregon single season record, 1836, 17 touchdowns. He was fourth nationally, as you saw in the graphic. But he also catches the ball out of the backfield. He had 26 catches, a couple of touchdowns that way. So I would think that Dakota Prukop is going to try to get the ball in the hands of number 21.
Oh, yeah. They're going to use him out there for sure because of the type of player he is.
Speaking of speed, and we go fast in Eugene, how about Devin Allen? He's not on the field today playing, but he is with Jill.
Absolutely, and he is in uniform. But, yeah, taking the spring off to focus on track. Tell us about how you're preparing for the Olympics coming up this summer.
Yeah, I've just been mostly track training, like you said. I'm not doing any spring practices. You know, just making sure my body stays healthy and I can get into track shape and get where I want to be in track and field.
And you're a two-sport athlete, obviously, here. What are some of the things that you have to go through and get the coaches to talk to each other, figure out your schedules, and work all of that logistically to do so?
The most important thing right now is just weightlifting. So Coach Rad, being the football and track strength coach, is really easy because he can kind of, you know, tailor my weight programs to me, and so that's been working out pretty well.
So they know what you can do, obviously, as a wide receiver. They've seen it. But how are you involved in spring practice? Do you still show up? Do you still talk to the guys and kind of give them pointers here and there?
Yeah, I just try to coach them up when I can. We're not on offense right now, but I'm subbing in and out the guys on the Webfoots for offense, and I'm kind of coaching them up as they go, and making sure if they don't know what they're doing, that I can tell them. If they need some help, I can let them know.
Now, as a wide receiver, you have to be watching the quarterbacks out there. Can you give us a little sneak peek of what you've seen in practice this spring?
They look really good. Both of them are really, really good athletes that can run, so that's always a plus to have somebody that's mobile in the pocket. And, you know, we saw some of the guys, they're still young in decision-making, but I think it's going to be a good season for us.
Well, before we get a change of possession, I'll let you get back there so you don't miss out on any substitutions for the Webfoots. Thanks for your time, Devin.
Thank you.
Jim?
Devin Allen, you saw the highlight. He won the NCAA's indoor title at 60 meters, and he was the last guy out of the blocks and then just closed on everybody. His technique is flawless, and he ran a career best 7:56, which is just blurry fast. But, 2014, he won the NCAA title in the 110 hurdles. He won it here at Hayward Field, and that's important because he's trying to make the Olympic team, and the Olympic trials will be right here in Tracktown, USA, July 1st through the 10th. So he'll be running in front of a home crowd, his chance to make the U.S. Olympic team. On the field now, the white team is Mighty Oregon, and there's Charles Nelson. Everybody who watches Oregon football knows all about Charles Nelson. Remember that he began last season as a wideout, then moved to safety midseason. Still managed to have 17 catches last year. And on the other side of the ball, two picks. Now in spring, he's been Prukop's favorite target. So we'll see if those two guys continue to hook up today. It's the 2016 Oregon Spring Game, live on the Pac-12 Network.
Home of the Oregon Ducks. You're watching Pac-12 Oregon.
Congratulations to the four Pac-12 athletes drafted in the first round of the NFL Draft. The Pac-12 is proud to call you our own. Congratulations and good luck.
If. Just two simple letters, right? Wrong. If searches and researches and shows up when you least expect it. If hangs with Nobel and Guggenheim and is cracking this kind of code and that kind of code. If walks like a duck and quacks like a duck and goes for it on fourth down. It all starts with if. Because if becomes when, and when becomes now, and now becomes how, and how becomes wow. We if at the University of Oregon.
Mark Helfrich, you get a feeling that he's a smiling cobra. He's charismatic, accommodating, nice, but underneath, you know that there's a vicious side.
He feels like he's part of a collective effort to carry the torch and set the bar where this thing has been for so long, and he's effectively done that.
I don't know if there's a guy in this Pac-12 conference more deserving of Coach of the Year than Mark Helfrich. What an outstanding job to finish this season that he's done.
Mark Helfrich begins his fourth season as the head coach in Eugene since he took over. 33-8 postseason appearances each time. And he experienced more success in his first two seasons than any head coach in history. And they've had it going on here in Eugene for a while. Kirk Merrick with a catch and run. Helfrich, by the way, got a new 5-year deal last February that runs through 2020. And here's the kicker to it. That new deal has an automatic 1-year rollover. Every season, he wins 11 games. Last year, they only won 9. What do you think of the job he did last year?
I think he did a great job. He brought in a transferred quarterback, one that wasn't a part of the system previously. That quarterback was injured. They had a lot of turnover and change, and yet to win that many games, be that competitive, and get better as the year went on, I think he did a great job as coach last year. And you know, the thing is, nobody wants to be the guy after the guy. And that's exactly the job he took on, and they've been better. That speaks volumes that he's maintained quality like that after Chip Kelly left.
Here's what's happened here in Eugene the last 6 seasons. and that last non-bowl season was all the way back in 2004. So you understand why I said at the beginning that 9-4 season left everybody here with mixed feelings. On the run, Travis Johnson finds his receiver, and it's Farrell Brown. And every time Farrell Brown does anything positive today, this crowd's going to get loud. Joe Savage already told you why. Coming off the injury, been a long time since he's been on this field. That has got to be an awesome feeling for that young man.
And what you see is what Farrell Brown brings to the table. A little better speed. It's just a deep out. It was a nice read and throw, but what you love, how about that hand strength? Full extension of the arms, grabs that ball out there. Great hands by Farrell Brown.
Traumatic leg injury late in 2014, and he will be a major pass-catching threat.
Brings up another one right here.
Dude's got a big straight arm, too. When he makes a catch, he's gonna knock some people off him. Look how big the guns are.
Well, right there's an example of why you love a tight end. Safety's too small. He just used his body, shields a safety. You're not going to make that. You're not going to break that play as a safety.
Fotu Liato is the guy who made the catch, or made the tackle on his catch before, the guy with the Polamalu hair coming out of the back of the helmet. Tony Burks James again. Last year, you could characterize this backfield as Royce Freeman and a committee of three. The three were Benoit, Brooks James, and Taj Griffin, and you expect it to be that way again. I asked both Matt Lubeck and Mark Helfrich, are you guys going to try to distribute just a little bit better in the backfield? And they said, well, we have Royce Freeman, so why aren't you going to give him the majority of the carries? And it's hard to argue with.
You know, when I work in construction, I drive a pickup truck. That's my pickup truck. I don't want to. Yeah. I don't drive a Prius to the site and then work. I drive a truck. That's my truck. I got Royce Freeman, man. I am. That's the horse that brought me to the rodeo, so to speak. That's the one I'm riding him.
Well, Duck fans call him Rolls Royce Freeman because, yeah, you're going in style with that guy, aren't you? Travis Johnson tries to elude, and the whistle comes in. They'll stop play. Remember, no contact on the quarterbacks today. We've talked about the offense coordinator. Here's the new defensive coordinator. And everybody's familiar with Brady Hoke. He's in his first season here, but his 30th year collegiate coaching experience. Spent those 4 years as the head coach at Michigan. And, you know, Helfrich said that he thought that Brady likes the fact that he's not the head coach right now, that he doesn't have to do the PR and the media and the glad handing, that he can get back to coaching football. And he told us this great story. The first practice of the spring, defense is on one side of the field, offense is on the other, and the teams are warming up, running in circles, and as they pass each other, Hoke yells over to Helfrich, I love this. Yep. He's a football guy.
People say, well, why would a guy, and this has happened many times, you know, Coach Erickson going to the Sun Devils and being a coach, and then Utah for his running backs coach, Brady Hoke, head coach, coming to be a coordinator. Why do they do it? Because they love coaching. They love being around the game. They love being around the kids. And you see, this is what they were last year. You know, you look at a lot of high numbers and last. Well, you do that. You want to improve those numbers. They bring in Brady Hoke to do that. And it's too bad that Brady Hoke is mostly known as the coach of Michigan when he had very successful stints at San Diego State as a head coach, at Ball State as a head coach. I mean, going all the way back, he was at Oregon State when I played at Arizona in the Pac-10 back in those days. He's been around a long time and had a ton of success.
And you mentioned the two West Coast jobs, so this is his third stop out here, his second in the state of Oregon. Helfrich said that he's refreshed, he's excited. And you know what else he is? He's honest, because we asked him about this defense. He said, we're a long way right now from where we want to be. We've got a lot of work to do.
What you see right here, you know, a problem with the pitch on the reverse. You're going to see those issues when you split your team up. You're going to see penalties on your offensive line, probably a little more pressure on the quarterback because they're not used to communicating. Things like reverse that take timing and a lot of practice, those will be issues today because these guys aren't used to being in practice together all the time because they run with their unit more than they run with each other.
Charles Nelson, another catch. Told you that he and Prukop have really hooked up in the spring. Several touchdown plays in drills. And Nelson is going up against Arian Springs a lot of time, and that's his roommate. So it's got to be a lot of talk. Royce Freeman with a catch in the flat, and he's hit immediately. That's Troy Dye getting up with the contact.
What you like, though, Royce Freeman hit immediately and then dragged the guy that hit him about 5 or 6 yards. He couldn't, not forward, but trying to get there. Took another guy coming to finish the job. He's one of those guys, you know, he's got great speed. He's got incredible strength. and he can be elusive. So when you talk about those qualities in a running back, you know, you were saying, could he be the best in the country? Absolutely he can. As a true freshman, he walked out. I'll never forget him. This one of the very first games of the year, his true freshman year, and it's pregame, and it's not even pregame. We're actually in the coach's offices, and he's walking around, and there's no way that guy's a true freshman. He looked the part right then. He is thick, and his personality is such that he's quiet and easygoing.
Helfrich said he's just one of those guys you want to be around. He just makes the room more fun. And we asked him how his Freeman can be better this year as a junior than he was as a sophomore when he set the school's single-season rushing record. And he said, well, he's already running better patterns. He's improved his blocking skills. He's better in protection. And he's added elusiveness.
See, and it's interesting that you say that, what you just said there, because people, I think, they look at rushing yards. They don't look at all the things a back has to do well to play at the next level. He has to understand that, and when he says his routes are better, they have to be precise. A bad route leads the ball to the defender. A bad route is tough on your quarterback. It's tough on your offensive line. If you aren't great at blocking, you get your quarterback killed. You can't put you on the field. All those little things are really what make a great running back, not just the fact that he can run with the ball. A
couple of catches there by Jared Lacoste, and Munt got another one. A different quarterback. This is Terry Wilson. He's a freshman, Del City, Oklahoma, and he's impressed everybody, not just with his arm, but with his feet. He actually had a 50-yard touchdown run in scrimmage last week. And everybody was talking about this guy as a prospect of the future, but he's kind of snuck up in spring, and he's closed that gap for the backup spot. You can see his command right here. I mean, this kid's 18 years old, and he's out there. You know, he's been on campus for what, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, and he's out there pointing guys into the right spot.
Well, they said he's just a natural for their system. The way they run things, he's a real natural for them. And here's all the quarterbacks right now that they have on the roster and who they can go to.
We saw Taylor Alley already catch a ball today out of the backfield. So some of these guys might show up in different positions, but you see all the youth there at the bottom. Remember, Johnson's only a freshman. So you would figure at this point that Prukop is the guy. And it's the third straight year that they're going to have a different guy under center. It was Mariota, and then it was Vernon Adams. And now we think it's going to be Dakota Prukop on September 3rd against UC Davis here in the opener. But it's nice to know that you have Travis Johnson right behind. What was it that Lubick said? In this offense, we'd like to have three healthy quarterbacks who can run our offense, but we need two, because it's rare that you're going to have a guy go the entire season. Remember, Mariota never missed a game during his Heisman season, but last year, Vernon Adams, he missed three starts with injuries. That's David Yost, former Missouri offensive coordinator. Last year, he was the receivers coach at Washington State. He's easy to find when you look over for signals.
You know, when you drive through Missouri, there's all these things that say walnut bowls for sale. I think he went there and got a haircut. I don't think he got the bowl.
It's a nice run by Terry Wilson. What did I just tell you? It's not just his arm, but it's his feet. And people in Oregon want to see that. Does David Yost want his quarterbacks to run? Isn't that part of this offense?
Absolutely it is, but you don't want him to run in a drop back. You want him to run when you have run pass option, the RPOs to the outside, where it's not as deadly. When you have your inside outside zone reads, you want that. Those are designed runs. When you're running just because the protection broke down, that's not where you want it to happen.
So Matt Lubeck's the offensive coordinator, but he said something during our call that I thought was great. He said, look, I'm going to defer to other guys. David Yost certainly is going to help me out with quarterbacks. Steve Greatwood's going to handle the offensive line. Greatwood was here when they broke ground on the school in the 1870s. So he knows he doesn't know everything. He's a young offensive coordinator. He says there are no egos on this coaching staff. We're all going to be held accountable, and I'm going to be asking for help. 3-0 in the Oregon Spring Game on the Pac-12 Network.
It's the dawn of a new season. The days are longer. The weather is warmer. And beasts are beginning to stir. A new season of Pac-12 sports is here. Spring Fever? Follow Pac-12 Spring Sports all season long on Pac-12 Network, where champions play.
It is go time. 4 years, 23 NCAA softball titles. Pac-12 softball is the best of the best. It's a party at the plate on Pac-12 Networks, where champions play.
12 universities, 450 live events. Pac-12 Network. If your TV provider does not offer it, go to pac-12.com/contact provider and request it. Catch all the action on Pac-12 Network.
Coming up on the next Inside Pac-12 Football, Oregon is the final team to wrap up spring ball. Get your first look at their newest grad transfer quarterback. And we break down where the Pac-12 stars landed in the NFL draft. That's later today at 1 p.m. Pacific on Pac-12 Network.
It's the Oregon spring game in front of 30,000.
Here with Eric Armstead. And, of course, Oregon Ducks, there's a lot of crossover. There are a lot of 49ers fans that live here in Oregon. But I have to ask you, Eric, because a former coach here at Oregon got the head job at the San Francisco 49ers. What was your initial reaction when you saw Chip Kelly was going to be your coach?
I was excited. Chip recruited me here to Oregon, and he left me, and, you know, now we're back together. And I think he's going to bring a lot of positive.
Now, we know that Chip likes to draft Pac-12 players. We've seen that. But DeForest Buckner was just taken 7th overall by the 49ers. United with DeForest in the NFL. What were your thoughts when you saw that?
Man, I was just, I wanted him to be in a good situation where he wanted to go, but I know once we were on the clock and he was still on the board, I was like, we have to take him, and we're going to be playing together. You know, I left early, and we always reminisce on what if I would have stayed for my senior year, and now we get to play together again.
So what advice do you have for him? Because you've been in the NFL for a year, to bring him along with you.
I'm going to help him. I'm going to try to help him a lot the best I can. You know, off the field stuff, getting your life off the field settled so you can be the best player you can on the field. So anything he needs, I'm helping with.
Well, thanks for your time. We really appreciate it. Best of luck.
Appreciate it.
Jim?
You guys were talking about DeForest Buckner, Pac-12 Defensive Player of the Year, won the Morris Trophy as the best defensive lineman in the conference, led the conference in sacks, now going to San Francisco as Chip Kelly uses that number 7 pick. And Buckner now the 5th Duck picked in the first round over the last 4 years. You know, that's the testament, and that to me is how college football has changed over the last 20 years. It's now more like college basketball, and that college coaches are saying, you come to my program, I'll get you ready. They used to talk that way. It was all about school first, but now they're talking about getting kids ready for the rest of their life.
Well, the coaches are finally talking like that. Believe it or not, kids always thought that.
Sure.
Kids thought that way, but the coaches, you know, they were talking the party line. It's about getting your education. Well, they know that kids are going to leave the NFL. They've opened it up to juniors. Juniors are going. So as a coach, part of your recruiting strategy has to be, we get you ready for the next level. And now, of course, the Ducks can prove over and over through the draft how many guys go in the first round from this program.
And certainly this is a program that highlights guys and gets the PR out there. We all know about the Oregon machine and how even people as far away as Florida and the ACC and the SEC, they know about the players, they know about this program.
Well, and what they've done, they did a great job of understanding that in order to overcome the decades of poor play they had here, that as they started winning, that they weren't known, that they didn't have a well-known tradition or history.
That's right.
So they embraced it. They started just going crazy with the uniforms, the facilities. And every kid across the country saw it and said, who is that? I want to go there. Look at those unis. Look at the way they change things.
Look at the way they play.
Yeah, and it just became this snowball effect that they were ahead of the curve that way. Now, a lot of the things they pioneered through with the Nike and changing their uniforms and the helmets, everybody's doing that. It's become part of the landscape of college football. But it all started with this kind of thought process of, we don't have a lot of history. Let's embrace that. Let's get out there. And they sold themselves nationwide. And when you look at their roster, they get kids from everywhere now.
Aiden Schneider with a 42-yarder. Just wide as he hooks it around the upright. Aiden Schneider last year, 22 of 24 on field goal attempts. Both of his misses came between 30 and 39 yards on PATs. He was perfect, 67 for 67. Aiden Schneider, a former walk-on got a scholarship right before the bowl game last year. That's always a great day at practice when the coach walks out and he gathers everybody around. He starts talking about a guy like Aiden who walked out, found a way to get on the field, contribute, and then he says, and today we'd like a player. The place just goes crazy.
Well, what it tells you is when you see the rest of the players go crazy, you know what walk-ons mean to the program. Walk-ons are sometimes hated and reviled by the players, but they love them because those guys work their tail off. Those guys are the guys that always go full speed even when you probably shouldn't because they're trying to make an impression on coaches. The guys that make it to that level, that get that scholarship, they're still always walk-ons, man. They know that in their heart. They still call themselves walk-ons. But they're loved when they get that scholarship by the rest of the guys because those guys know the work and the passion that goes into being a walk-on and getting that scholarship.
That's right, the investment. Kenai Benoit with a couple of carries back-to-back. Even saw the kids are giving Puddles some love today, the Oregon mascot. Benoit backed up Freeman. Last year was hampered by a little bit of injury. Still carried the ball over 50 times. You're going to see a lot of that this year. I think Oregon's going to use the tight ends a lot more this year. Evan Bayless with a catch and run.
You know, good coaches coach their personnel. They have three, four really good tight ends on this roster. Mont and Brown and Bayless. They're going to – you got to get those guys on the field. They're weapons.
All-star, 75 of the offense. Five-yard penalty. Down remains one.
And here's the second false start we've seen. We've seen a little bit of breakdown in protection. Offensive line, they're trying to replace three starters, and they're splitting them up right now. So you don't have your group, even the two guys that played together, aren't necessarily going to always be right next to each other out here. So we're starting to see a little communication breakdown, a little bit of pressure. That's a real question mark for this Ducks team is who's going to replace the center, the left guard, the left tackle, the losses they had along the line.
Again, it's Benoit, short gain off the left side, getting back to that offensive line. Well, that's all going to be up to Steve Greatwood. He's been here 29 years now. He only gets two starters back on that offensive line. He gets Tyrell Crosby back. He was a tackle last year. Cameron Hunt, a guard, but they might even move guys around. And of course, the key to the offensive line is, as it is on every team, is the center. Right now, they're looking at the redshirt freshman number 55, Jake Hansen. Comes out of Eureka in Northern California. Hansen was the backup center, second unit last year. Matt Hegarty, of course, the starting center last year. Hegarty got hurt in the Alamo Bowl. They lost, what, three guys, including the quarterback Vernon Adams in about a five-minute period of that game when it all turned around and went south on him.
Yeah, and it shows, you know, everybody wants to point at the quarterback.
Look at Prukop just showing the arm. He just stood there flat-footed, looked off the corner, and then turned back and threw that ball about 55 yards in the air. And just overthrow.
The coach was going to love it. It had been about 50 yards.
That's right.
55.
Dylan Mitchell on the fly here. Dylan Mitchell's really been impressing people. Yeah, he overthrew it by a couple of yards. Dylan Mitchell's a freshman from Memphis, Tennessee, and they just say he's a playmaker. But he's got to find his place in this rotation. As always, Oregon is super deep at the wideout spot.
Well, and that's all the teams that run spread option or zone read, whatever you want to call it, they have to have a lot of wide receivers. They're running so many plays, wide receivers get tired. They got to rotate them in and out. They have to have three squads out there, wide receivers, just to keep guys fresh enough to keep playing.
Prukop trying to keep that play alive with his feet, but he ran right into the defense as soon as they touched him. And blow the whistle. Markel Fritch, center might be a little ragged. Doesn't look too bad. Webfoots in Mighty Oregon on the Pac-12 Network.
Before you see it on TV.
He's going to score.
Before it posts to your timeline.
Oh, look at that.
Even before you see it in your newsfeed.
It worked.
It lives here. Download Pac-12 now so you can watch your team anytime, anywhere.
Welcome back inside Autzen Stadium. I have wide receiver Charles Nelson here with me, and I'm going to ask you first because we don't have the defensive back out there in front of your name anymore because it's just wide receiver this spring. What's it like for you now focusing solely on wide receiver again?
It's great so far, you know, just being able to work at one position, just go out there every day and work with the receivers is great, you know. Just putting in the work with all those guys and just being with them every day has been a great thing.
What are some of the nuances in your game that you're trying to improve this spring and heading into summer?
Just trying to be able to go full speed every play, you know, play every game, you know, every play on offense, you know, not even be able to come out, get better at running routes a little bit, and just going from there.
Now, as a wide receiver, I'm going to have to ask you what it's like with the quarterback competition. Everybody's been talking about it all spring long, but what insight can you give us on the guys that have been taking reps this spring?
It's been a great battle to watch, you know. As a receiver, just going out there every day with those guys and seeing them compete, you know, there's no clear winner right now. It's just they're out there competing against each other, and they're having fun doing it, so it's been great.
In the running back stable, we all know Royce Freeman is going to be the starter. He's going to be the workhorse, but there's a competition to see who's going to be out there with him on the field. Anybody that you've seen in the running back group kind of stick out this season?
Basically, all the running backs have been doing a great job. You know, some guys have been getting hurt every now and then, but I see, you know, Tony and Taj and Kanai just going out there having their best games no matter what.
Well, thanks for your time. Really appreciate it. Best of luck at wide receiver this season.
Thank you.
Charles Nelson.
Yeah, Charles Nelson, who played on both sides of the ball, as Jill just told you. And Matt Lubeck, the offensive coordinator, talked about Nelson and his ability to do so many things. He said he's never satisfied. He always sits in the front row. He's always taking notes and asking questions because it's important for him to be good. And this is a guy, Charles Nelson, who's used to being moved around in high school back in Dayton Beach, Florida. He was at Seabreeze High School. He was a tailback.
Well, when you see him with the ball, you can see that he has ball carrying experience. He's, whether it be in the return game, both sides of the ball, he's a football player. That's the highest praise another football player can give.
Still is.
He's a player. Guy's a football player.
Or the cheerleaders already in midseason form. And look at the stands, man. I mean, this is awesome. You know, some of the spring games, you know, people wander out, take a look. And you have 5,000-6,000 people maybe throughout the day. You have 30,000 people. Glenn, I showed up 2 hours before the game. There were 1,000 people at the gate in line ready to come in and look at an empty field for 2 hours.
And tailgating and having fun, festival seating. You know, but it's more than that. This is a community event. This and Oregon, as a state, is a community. It's very much a separate, it's what they are. And this is an event for them. And they come out, they show it, they support, obviously support the military, but support their team really well. It's an event, man. I love it. It's this is when it's fun at spring games to see the excitement and enthusiasm, not only of the players out there. Moloata just going crazy.
Here's all you need to know about the University of Oregon. They have 25,000 students. Stadium holds 54,000. That's how important it is to the Eugene Springfield community. And of course, people driving all the way down from Points North all the way up to Portland. I love it. All right, so we've been talking about the guys who are here. What are the holes they're trying to fill? Well, you lose Vernon Adams, of course, 2,600 yards, 26 touchdowns. We talked about DeForest Buckner, led the Pac-12 in sacks. Byron Marshall, played on both sides of the ball, dangerous kick returner as well. Braylon Addison, team's leading receiver, 800 yards. Joe Walker led the Ducks with 87 tackles. Tyler Johnstone, part of the three that are gone on the offensive line. Remember that the Ducks averaged 279 yards rushing. You know, Helfrich, I think, is going to want to stay somewhat balanced. And Jim Mora last week, a UCLA coach, told us balance doesn't mean running the same amount of plays, pass and run. It means doing each equally well. They're very creative here. But last year, you know, they did very well on the ground. You expect to see the same thing with Royce Freeman? Why not, right?
I do expect that. I think you're going to run the ball effectively at times, and there's times you can pass the ball effectively. Situation will dictate, but that's what balance means.
Matt Lubeck, the offensive coordinator, says, we think we have the best back in the country. Well, right now, we have him. He's with Jill Savage.
That's right. Royce Freeman here with me now. I was telling him, I go, I thought you were going to have two carries today, and then your day would be done. You said you didn't even get a carry out there today. They were just throwing to you.
Yeah, a little pass and catch.
Is that one of the things that you've been working on? I mean, we know you're such a good back, but coaches were telling us that you're trying to add some nuances to your game in pass protection and also some running some routes. So what have you been working on specifically?
Pass protection is pretty important. So, I mean, we want to throw the ball, so I got to be able to get block those bigger guys. So, I mean, that's a task in itself. And going out and making plays out of the backfield, showing versatility, catching the ball, and getting yards.
Coach Helfrich has called you the best practice player on the team. How do you bring it every day and make sure that your level is up to the Oregon standard?
Well, the guys around me, the guys in the backfield, we push each other. And
It's just for a bigger cause. It's not for me. It's for the guys around me and the people who got me here. So, I mean, I think about that every day when I'm feeling tired, and I just ramp it up.
Now, we know that you're going to be the number one running back, but there are going to be some other guys out there. They said they don't want to have you carrying the ball 35 times if they don't have to. So the other guys that are around you, how have you been seeing them progress?
I mean, I feel like we've matured a lot as a backfield. We've been together for a couple years now, and we've been helping each other out. We've been wanting to get better. And the fact that we have such talent back there, I mean, that's gonna make us competitive in itself. So, I mean, it's not a bad problem to have.
Thanks so much for your time, Royce. Really appreciate it. Jim?
Thank you, Jill. Yeah, Royce is talking about Taj Griffin, Tony Brooks, James, and Kenai Benoit, the other three guys in the backfield with him. Really glad that Jill brought up that comment that Hilfrich said about what a great practice player Royce Freeman is. In fact, Hilfrich complimented him in front of the entire team because they had a drill. They had scout team kickoff coverage, and he needed one more body. Who runs up? Royce Freeman. He's a lead by example guy, and Hilfrich sees him and says, man, look at this guy, he says to the rest of the team. Were his legs tired? You bet. Has he made some plays in his career? Yeah, he sure has. And was he the first guy lined up and we just needed a body? Yes, he was. That's who Royce Freeman is. That's why he's a leader on this team. And if you practice the way you play, you better practice hard.
Well, absolutely. And you know what it speaks to is he's not comfortable. A lot of guys, if they become the man, they become comfortable.
It's a great way to look at it.
And he's not. He's not. He wants to be better. He wants to make sure because he knows they recruit talent every year. There's another kid on the roster that could be just as good or better than him. He's trying to separate himself. He's trying to say, hey, I'm not the man. I'm a guy who gets the ball in this offense a lot, but that's about it.
Royce Freeman rushed for over 100 yards in all but two games, Michigan State and Utah. Those were both losses. His best game of the year against Washington State, 246 yards.
I don't know that I've ever run 246 yards like at one time.
You got to get a Fitbit. From Imperial, California, Imperial High School. Again, as a freshman, first true freshman in school history to go 1,000 yards. Last year, over 1,800. Another 350 through the air. Heck yeah, three touchdowns in the Alamo Bowl, 130 yards. Quiet guy by nature, but pretty loud when he puts on the helmet. Keeping it is Travis Johnson. You know, we knew that we wouldn't see the starters for an awful lot today. So already I think Terry Wilson has made a pretty good impression. The freshman quarterback who right now is probably third on David Yost's chart. Should go Prukop and then Travis Johnson and then Terry Wilson. What we don't know are the gaps between those two teams or those three players right now. Tony Brooks James with a nice carry.
Yeah, shows a little suddenness. It's the pin and pull on the offensive line, and he just tucks himself in, gets to the outside hip, which is, you know, they often say it, a running back is his own best blocker.
There he is again.
He's got to be the guy who sets the blocks up, or else it doesn't do any good for offensive linemen to be running around out there. So he did a nice job on that one, and this one was a much quicker hitter, just a little, what you almost call a veer, but an inside zone.
TBJ, redshirt sophomore from Gainesville, Florida. Only carried the ball 32 times last year. Here's the thing that Matt Lubeck pointed out, and obviously he knows this team better than we ever will. Talking about the other guys, not Royce Freeman, but that committee of three, Taj Griffin, Tony Brooks James, and Kenai Benoit, each one of those other guys averaged at least 7 yards a carry. Benoit, 7, James, 9, and Taj Griffin averaged 7.5 yards a carry. I think that's important. When teams are keying on Freeman, you've got to have somebody else to carry the rock.
Well, you've got to have that change of pace. You've got to have something that's different than what's already in there, and that's what those guys represent. You get used to a certain pattern, used to a certain pace with runners, and that's what they bring. And this, when you look at the schedule sets up for them nicely. You know,
sure does.
A couple of games early on to get their feet wet, so to speak. Virginia is a tough one, but you have to go to Nebraska, and you're going to play a Mike Riley team that really got better and better as year went on, and he knows this Oregon program. He knows it well.
That's right. Yeah.
So you got that. But then you look and you go Colorado, and the way it's kind of sets through, there's no long homestands, no long road where they're on the road all the time. They've got a real chance again to win the North.
Yeah, that's the thing. Three of the first four at home, and their longest road trip is at the end of the season, and one of those is right up the freeway in Corvallis. So I think it's favorable for the Ducks.
But what do we know? There's no such thing as an easy Pac-12 schedule. We referenced it, you know, last week. We talked about it. It's the only conference where every team had a conference loss. So it's not easy in the Pac-12.
At home, yeah. Minute to go in the first half. The second half will be a running clock. There he is again. Tony Brooks James. He's only 5'9", 185, but he is the fastest of all the backs. So if they get him to the corner, then exponentially he gets more dangerous. Helfrich was talking about these all these backs, and he said, my biggest concern is how we're going to get all of these talented guys the football. And then he pointed out that those other three helped make Freeman better. Catch in the back of the end zone for the touchdown is Johnny Munt. I'll tell you what, Johnny Munt has already impressed me today. You know, we're happy to see Farrell Brown out there, but Johnny Munt has made some good catches. Dude's got good hands, good feet, and he's got some speed for a tight end.
Well, it's nice when you're running play action pass. Safeties has to bite a little bit.
Oh, he bobbled it. They're going to call it incomplete.
That's right.
Got to carry it to the ground.
And you just gave him all the love on the hands.
I did. All right. He's got it here. One, two, and then the strip, and the ball pops. No catch. Webfoots with the ball, leading 3-0. Again, this is a throwback, these blue and gold uniforms, white on the opposite side to that 1916 team, went to the very first Rose Bowl in school history, and almost another goal line pick. We've seen one already today.
And just for the fans don't know, Webfoots does not reference the Ducks.
No, it was the, let's see if I know this, it's the Northeastern.
Northwestern.
Well, the Northeastern fishermen who migrated.
That's correct.
To Oregon in the late 1800s. That was their nickname, right?
Yeah, they were the Webfoots.
Webfoots, then the Webbers, and then the Ducks. Tony Brooks James, you saw earlier, went down kind of hard, maybe landed on the stick. And is it his hand or is his foot? Looks like he's shaking that right wrist.
Yeah.
It got caught underneath him. This is the one thing every coach says about spring. We don't want to get anybody hurt. Here comes Schneider looking for another field goal straight on. And pushed it right, but bends it back. 6-0. There's that familiar horn. Oh, check it. He's kicking for the other side here. That's right. They're moving quarterbacks and kickers on both sides of the ball. So it levels the game at 3. Tony looks like he's okay now. Well, that's good news. Wrap it up. You got 125 days until UC Davis. You always carry it with the other hand, too, can't you?
Well, you know, I'd like my running back to be able to have good, healthy hands. But it looks like it's right on the back. He might have gotten cut because they looked like they were just covering it there. You know, you don't like to speculate on injuries, obviously, but he's much better spirits than just a moment ago.
If you're one of these other three guys, you can't help but like Royce Freeman, but you want to carve out your own spot, right?
Sure. You got to work. So you see how he works? You got to work a little bit harder than him.
46 seconds here for the white side, Mighty Oregon. See if they can get into field goal range as well. And actually now they did put that field goal back on the Webfoot side. Jeff Lockie with the catch, another backup quarterback who actually is the most experienced quarterback. He's the guy who started 3 times in place of Vernon Adams last year. Pressure coming. Brewcup maybe held it a little bit long there. Can't tackle him. Dylan Mitchell with the catch. Freshman that made such an impression. There's Jeff Lockie from Alamo, California. His numbers last year pretty good. He threw 100 balls. Just under 600 yards, 4 interceptions, and 5 touchdowns. But he was also under center in games in which Oregon lost leads against Washington State and TCU. You can't hang it just on the one guy, of course. They averaged 43 points a game last year. They scored over 50 four different times. The Alamo Bowl last year, it started out so well. Oregon led 31-0 before Vernon Adams got hurt. And after that, the wheels came off. The Horned Frogs scored 17 in the third, 14 in the fourth, while shutting out Oregon in the second half. Game went to overtime before the Ducks' last chance falls incomplete. TCU comes back from 31 down to win it 47-41. I thought it was really interesting. You asked Markel Fritch, how do you get over a loss like that? How do you let it go? And it was interesting because the first thing he said is, you got to own it first.
See, I love that. That's the message you send your team about self-responsibility, about taking ownership of your mistakes. That's huge. That's a great message to send to your kids. And, I that's a great message every kid needs to learn. You're not a victim. It's not someone else's fault. Own it.
Helfrich's quote, we had to hang on to it to get over it. We had to take ownership of it and use it appropriately. It was a chance to make a negative a productive. Certainly it was a learning lesson. And he kind of laughed when we brought it up because, you know, how many times has he played that game back in his head?
Yeah. He second-guessed himself a million times on every call. If I'd have called this, we could have done that. But you got to move on. And that's the thing, having lost five Super Bowls. Trust me, I know. You say, okay, I own it. I lost that one. I'm going to come back better the next time. And that's how you get to five Super Bowls. That's how they're going to get better, is taking that ownership.
You brought it up, and I've always wanted to ask you that. I mean, anybody makes it to the NFL, that's unbelievable. To get to a Super Bowl, that's a once-in-a-lifetime. You had it five times. Does it really bother you that you lost all five? Certainly you would have liked to have won one, but don't you take a lot of pride in the fact you made it to five Super
Absolutely.
Bowls?
Absolutely. I was a part of five great teams. Great guys, great teams, families, coaching staffs. Does it bother me? Absolutely, because I'm a competitor. I wanted to win one.
Oh, in the corner. Here he is, Dylan Mitchell.
That was an incredible job of adjusting to the ball, contorting his body as he went up and making that grab. That was just, that's the type of thing, if this is the fall, that is top 12, that is the crowd going crazy. Watch him go up for this ball. This is incredible.
Oh, he just out jumps the cornerback. Mitchell's 6'1", 190. And I'm telling you, every day, the practice report brings this guy's name up. Maybe he gets away with a shove.
Oh, yeah. But he never extended his arms. The official was at his back. The
just
other
a little
official
pressure.
Didn't have a look. That was that's quality cheating right there.
Ugo Amadi, the cornerback on the play, is a starter for this team. Probably would have had something to say about it. Dylan Mitchell, when asked about his play, Helfrich said, he graduated from high school, White Station High School in Memphis, early, got here. And so we threw the whole playbook at him just to see if he could handle it. And he did. He said he came in here with a competitive attitude, and he's as good as a freshman receiver as we have ever had here. I mean, I underline that because just think of the guys who have come through here as pass catchers. And you're saying that right now this guy has as much potential as any freshman in Oregon history? You just saw a flash of it there. That's big stuff. Offensive coordinator, the new guy, Matt Lubeck with Jill Savage.
Thank you so much. Coach, let's start with you in your transition, first of all, as offensive coordinator. How's it gone so far this spring?
It's been fun. You know, I'm in a great situation with a lot of good players and great coaches that make my job easy.
Now, Charles Nelson told us a couple of minutes ago, he said there's no real winner right now at the quarterback spot. I know you guys aren't looking to name a starter, and I know you guys want several quarterbacks that can go out there and win, but how have they progressed throughout this spring?
They get better each day, and it's even Travis has been here a little bit longer, so he had a little bit leg up as far as knowing the system, but he's never really played, so this is his first time getting reps, and he's grown tremendously. And then Dakota, each day you can see just getting a better understanding of the offense and making a step. I'm happy with them both. Coach Yost is doing a great job with those guys. From where they were day one of spring ball till the end, it's pretty remarkable. And we feel like we're going to have more depth here than we've had in the past.
What's been your focus this spring? As you come in and take over and kind of put your stamp on it, what do you want to see when spring is done?
You know, we don't want to reinvent the wheel. We just want to get better at the things that we've done in the past. And then if we can, we're always in the business of if there's something we can do that'll make us a little better, we're going to do that. And then getting the right guys, the right ball, the right period of time, and playing fast, and we're going to continue to do that.
And kind of stealing Charles Nelson back on offense just for yourselves, that has to be kind of nice.
Yeah, that's a day-to-day thing. We got him for right now, though, so I'm happy with that.
Thanks for your time, Coach.
Thank you, Jill.
Jim?
Matt Lubeck, his fourth year on staff, first as the offensive coordinator. Of course, his dad, Sonny Lubeck, longtime college football coach. And Mark Helfrich says about the kid, about Matt, he's a very bright guy. He's detailed. He's a great recruiter. He's passionate. He was born to be a coach.
You're watching Pac-12 Oregon, home of the Oregon State Beavers and the Oregon Ducks. Available on Xfinity.
Before 8 and 13, there was 32. Before 14, there was 34. Before 24, there was the 24. Before 44, there was 22 and 18. And before them all, there was 42. Each played a role in this season's pursuit for number 29.
And the Bruins have done it. Their first ever national championship.
Pac-12 baseball. It's a numbers game.
March 27, 1939. Oregon and Ohio State faced off for the very first NCAA men's basketball championship in Evanston, Illinois. Known as the Tall Firs for their height advantage, Oregon opened up a five-point halftime lead and never looked back, as Oregon, led by John Dick's game-high 13 points, easily took care of the Buckeyes. The 46-33 victory for Howard Hobson's Webfoots was the Pacific Coast Conference's first NCAA men's basketball championship.
Sunday, it's gonna be a beachin' good time. Tune in to Pac-12 Network all day to get your beach volleyball fix. Coverage begins Sunday at 9 on Pac-12 Network, home of the Oregon State Beavers and the Oregon Ducks. You're watching Pac-12 Oregon.
If you're a football fan, it's awesome. You're going to get to watch how they build each block in building a team. I love it. If you're a football fan, you love it. Exciting.
Now the crowd is on its feet because Jake Olsen has stepped in to snap. He gets a standing ovation here at the Coliseum.
Is this the year the Buffs get back to their winning ways, get back to the postseason?
A beautiful day in West L.A. Jim Morris says plenty of talent on campus will be okay.
Who replaces Kevin Hogan?
Both guys proved to be viable candidates, and we're going to find out today who really is going to take that step forward going into training camp.
These are the struggles that Tim White has to go through when he plays on both sides of the ball.
And fans might not understand how tight those jerseys are.
Going to take a crack at the end zone. Got a man. Touchdown. That's Martin on the receiving end.
Jordan Velleman, touchdown.
And that's what Beaver fans want to see.
I'll get a little help there. Get a little help there. Oh, there you go.
Look at the traps here. This looks like...
Oh, he's got some shake to it.
Oh, look at that. Yes. That's a 12 best nominee, don't you think?
And counting down the days till fall camp opens.
Some of the sights and sounds around the Pac-12, all the spring games, and the final spring game taking place here at Autzen Stadium in front of 30,000. Mighty Oregon leads the Oregon Webfoots in 6 at half. Time. This is a throwback to the 1916 Oregon football team. Remember, that's when they were blue and gold, the original colors of the school. Went to the 1970 Rose Bowl. Jim Watson and Glenn Parker up high at Autzen Stadium. The pullover's on because the temperatures are in the high 50s and the breeze is blowing. It feels like a fall football Saturday with the crowd here, 30,000 people. Let's talk about the Pac-12 as a whole. Usual suspects again. Anybody going to surprise? Maybe you break it down north and south. Who do you like? You've seen a lot of them.
Well, you know, I think that there's just so many questions right now. Until we have to answer some questions. Quarterback questions in the north, obviously. Stanford, Cal, Oregon, trying to find quarterbacks. Down south, a little more settled, obviously, with UCLA. But Arizona State's up in the air. Utah's up in the air. Colorado's up in the air. So quarterback play, to me, is the big question right now within the entire conference. I don't know that anybody really has the edge up other than UCLA, who has a returning, proven starter.
This Oregon team last year finished 7-2 in conference, so they finished a game back of Stanford. Same thing again, because Stanford has to replace Hogan now. I hear Washington's going to be a much better team this year. What do you think about this side of things?
Well, I think Washington's much improved, and that they're building that program. Obviously, it was a good start already for Peterson, but the way he's put in the system, the way they go about building, you're starting to see a difference there. If they can settle in on a couple of key position battles, they can really make noise in the North.
You live in Arizona. Let's talk about those two schools. Mike Bercovici's gone at Arizona State. Everyone says, oh, they might be down a little bit. What about the Cats and the Devils?
Well, I think for the Sun Devils, finding a quarterback and replacing offensive linemen, they lost their interior of the offensive line, both guards and center. So they're going to have to do that, and that's a tough transition because that's the center of your offense between your offensive line and your quarterback. Yeah. It's tough. For the other side, I think the Cats are going to be who they have been the last 2 years. That's a team that can win 10 or a team that wins 5. All the toss-up games are going to be in the air for them, so I wouldn't be surprised either way with the Cats could go.
You and I were in Westwood last week. We saw UCLA, and of course the focus was on Josh Rosen, and everyone says you make the biggest jump from your freshman to your sophomore season. UCLA has the same problem, actually, that Oregon does. They lost half of their offensive line. What do you think about UCLA? You saw them for 2 hours.
I'm most excited about UCLA because I like what they're doing offensively. By bringing in Kennedy Polamalu, they're going to be a little more disciplined, a little more mentally tough, a little more grinded out. They're going to go north and south a bit more, play action pass. A lot of those things will protect a young Josh Rosen. So I think I'm excited to see that offense get going because I like smash mouth football.
Here at the University of Oregon, they too are changing quarterbacks. They'll have their third different starter in 3 seasons. So it looks like it's going to be Dakota Prukop. But Jerry Wilson has looked pretty good, and so has Travis Johnson. Second half coming up. We come back to Autzen.
Home of the Oregon Ducks. You're watching Pac-12 Oregon. Today, will the number 5 Ducks stay afloat at the top of the Pac-12 standings, or will number 17 Arizona muddy the waters? Today at 5 on Pac-12 Network. Find out how your team might fare in the Pac-12 North as Inside Pac-12 Football gives you a preview of the upcoming season. Tuesday at 7 on Pac-12 Network.
Anything. Greatness will take on anything. It will refuse oxygen, startle the crowd. Because greatness takes on anything, all it demands is someone to watch it go.
Hi, I'm Mark Helfrich, head football coach at the University of Oregon, and you're watching Pac-12 Oregon, where champions play.
Welcome back inside Autzen Stadium, one of the newest coaching additions. Defensive coordinator Brady Hoke here with me now, and I want to ask you what it's been like since you've gotten here in Eugene and on the Oregon campus for you.
Well, it's been great. You know, it's a bunch of great staff, guys who work extremely hard, knowing most of them for 23 to 28 years. It's been an easy transition. And, you know, as a coach, you know, your job's to get kids ready to play. So that's what we've been doing.
And you provided a spark of energy. Everybody's been talking about it. They're excited to move from a 3-4 to a 4-3 defense. I don't know if everybody at home really knows what that entails. So could you let us know what the plan is a little bit?
Well, you know, we wanted to base everything out of a 4-3, one-gap defense instead of two-gap defense. And just in how we're teaching it, it makes sense if we teach it first out of that, and then we can add some things in nickel and dime packages and some of your exotic things that you want to do. But for us, it's we got to play hard, got to play physical, got to play hard. You know, I was here in the spring, and just being around these guys enough, I don't think anything shocked me. The facilities are great. The kids really are trying to do the best they can.
All right, we'll get you back out there so you can go coach them up.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Brady Hoke, he just sounds like a football coach. New philosophy here, and I think Duck fans, they want to hear that because this wasn't a great defense last year, and this one is a 4-3 base package. It's designed attacking style. And help me out, Glenn, what's the difference between a one-gap and a two-gap philosophy on the defensive side?
Well, two-gap, traditional two-gap is where the defensive lineman stands the offensive lineman up, and he reads the gap. He controls both gaps. One, he's either playing two-gap by reading, or he controls one gap with his body and the other gap with the offensive lineman's body. So he holds ground. But an attacking one gap, this means they pick the gap, and they don't get to just pick it. It's designed through the defense. Hey, on this one you do that, and this. They'll attack the gap, get into that gap, and disrupt the offense. It's much more a defense that's based on getting up the field rather than reading inside to side.
And he said that some of these guys, it's hard to break their habits. They're so used to playing the two gap that the guy who's picked it up the easiest is – Elijah George, who was an offensive lineman, coming over because he doesn't have those old habits. How do you get guys out of that old thought process, two-gap, to move them over? And what's the advantage going one-gap?
Well, the advantage one-gap is it's aggressive. It's very aggressive defense. You're owning the gap. The hard part for habits is kids have been coached, and they've been punished if they didn't do it right for all those years. That's a tough habit to break. They need to just keep hammering away at it, hammering away, and they'll get there. The problem that you have with one-gap defenses, and one of the problems is, if two guys go to the same gap, if you get an overlap where there's a mistake, it opens up gashing plays against you. Now, it should, in theory, be more simple because you've only got one gap, you got to attack. But as we know, they're kids, and sometimes they make mistakes.
Kenai Benoit with his eighth carry of the game. He's the leading rusher in terms of touches in this game. Prukop looks like maybe hit his hand on somebody's helmet. He's okay, of course. You know, one thing that Brady Hoke did when he first got here, which I thought was impressive, and when I asked him about it, he said he's always done it this way. As you see what happened to Prukop, I don't think he hit anybody. He just...
Well, we know it could have happened maybe on a previous play. And
twisted the wrist. He's trying to shake it off. But what Hoke did when he first got here, he told the coaching staff, don't tell me about eyes. I want to come in with a fresh eye and make my own judgments. You like that approach?
Absolutely. Well, he doesn't want someone else's opinion. He wants to see them himself, see how they'll fit in with him, how they listen to him, how they communicate. Everybody's got to fight for their job. When you get a new coach, you got to impress the new coach. So I don't care, you're not safe. And that to me, that's the way to do it.
Took a year off, did some radio. He visited other schools. He said it was great because you get to see how other guys do things. You say, oh, I want to borrow that and other stuff. Oh, I'd never do that in a million years, but it opens your mind up. It always amazes me when you talk to coaches and they've been around the sport. Playing, some of these guys have been around the sport a half a century, yet every year they come back kind of pumped up with new ideas and new ways to do things. I mean, look at a guy like the offensive line coach, Steve Greatwood. He's not only been doing it a long time, he's been doing it a long time in the same place, yet he's all jacked every year. You crank it up.
Yeah, well, first off, you know, just the disclosure here, he recruited me here.
Yes.
In 1987, so that's how long he's been here and how old I am. But, yeah, they have these conventions and they get together and it's football is not 6 degrees of separation, it's two. Guys know everybody out there. And so when something new comes along or a way of figuring it out is out there, as you see Coach Greatwood right back there doing his job, you find new ways to communicate to the kids because the kids change. The kids are different now than they were 10 years ago and 20 years ago and 30 years ago. There's Coach, just a great, great guy. And, so they get jacked, they get pumped because ultimately it's teaching. And you get excited to teach kids and the light goes on. And it's when the light goes on some kid you've been working on, it's gratifying on a personal level.
And certainly more teaching this year than in past years because so much has changed here.
That's correct, yeah, very much so. And coach.
Steve Gray with 34 years as a player and a coach at Oregon. He began as a graduate assistant, elevated the offensive line coach here in 1982 when he was only 24 years old. And when we asked Helfrich, what does Steve Greatwood mean to this program? He said, quote, he's our bedrock. He's our loyal laboratory retriever. He's a stud. Is that a compliment?
Yeah, I think for an offensive lineman, that's a compliment.
All right. How about you follow the quarterback?
Well,
right? Look at Terry Wilson, the freshman. Just getting in the way.
Just remember, when you're the ball carrier, your own best blocker. You got to set those guys up. Set them, and then make your cut.
Jared Lacoste again. Dakota Prukop. My goodness. I mean, obviously you don't want anybody to get hurt. You certainly don't want your quarterback to get hurt. The only saving grace, no matter what happens today, is you have 125 days before UC Davis gets in. I don't know, maybe the medical staff needs to hone their game a little bit too today at the spring game. Everybody's got to do their job. Wilson looks one guy off, comes back late across the middle short. Ryan Bay with a catch. Dakota Prukop, 6'2", 195. 3,000 yards at Montana State. And Helfrich said his biggest obstacle right now, Dakota's biggest obstacle, is that he has an analytical mind, that he's a perfectionist. And he says, look, if you think too much in this offense, you're going to throw off the timing. When Dakota came on his official visit to Eugene, who hosted him? Vernon Adams. Not only were they both quarterbacks, both fifth-year transfers. And I think the fact that Vernon had so much success in that role really encouraged Dakota to come here, and he could do the same thing. Terry Wilson laying one out to nobody in particular. Maybe he was looking for Ryan Bay. Khalil Oliver also in the spot. Helfrich says he's going to name a quarterback. And when we asked him when, he said the natural place is 10 days, the 10-day run-up before the first game. So end of August, he'll name a starter.
That makes sense. Give yourself a chance to, he'll get a couple of full-go practices in, then a weekend, and then starting into the what they would call game week prep. So he'd have some time, a couple of days before that where to let it sink in, and a couple days before that to be the starter in full go. I think that's the proper way to do it.
When we were on the call with the coaches, Yogi Roth joined us, and he asked a really interesting question, because everybody says you need reps. So Yogi asked, and I think he asked Matt Lubeck, how many reps have you guys run in the 14 spring practices? And Lubeck, without hesitating, says, we want 140 per practice. So you do 140 times 14 practices, 1,960 reps. Now, everybody says, look, more reps isn't a guarantee you're going to get better, but are fewer reps a guarantee that you won't?
Well, and the question is, it's the quality of rep.
Exactly.
If you're not learning from your failures, I always tell people, don't be afraid of failure. Learn from it. Replicate success, learn from failure. The problem is when you replicate failure, and you hope that's not the case. You hope that your reps are quality, you're not replicating the failure, and you're moving on.
J.J. Jones with a carry, who was the Scout Team Offensive Player of the Year last season. Redshirt senior from L.A., Harvard Westlake. Great high school in the Los Angeles City area. Incomplete. Let's go back down on the field. Jill Savage with a great story. We've already seen it with a happy ending today.
Absolutely. Farrell Brown making his return to Autzen Stadium. You haven't played here since November 2014. What was it like getting back out there on the field?
It was pretty good being able to come out here in front of all the fans and everybody, just being able to run out the tunnel again and just being able to play the game that I love to play. It's a great feeling.
It's a remarkable story because you said a year ago you were lying in bed, you were moving with crutches. Now you're out here moving around. What was the most difficult part as you rehab getting back to where you are now?
The most difficult part was really just having everything taken away, like just not being able to do some of the small things that we don't even think about on a daily basis, and just not being able to be here and just kind of just being at home and just not being able to do what I was used to do was pretty hard for me.
And now you're back in, part of the team. You get to go on road trips again. I heard you said you didn't like watching the game by yourself last season. But now that you're back in here, the most successful part of this story for you will be what in the end?
The most successful part for me is just be able to play back with my team and hopefully get back to the national championship game or the college playoffs and be able to finish the story off the right way.
Now, we've seen a lot of the quarterbacks out there already this game. What is your insight on the quarterback battle this season?
I think they're both pretty good. They both have a lot of strengths, and I don't think any one of them at this point has stood out like that's who that guy is. But it's great competition. I mean, it's college football, so competition is here. So I love competition. So I kind of like them. I like to see them like going at it and trying to win the starting job.
Well, Farrah, thanks for your time. Really appreciate it.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Now, I don't know if it matters if the Webfoots or the Mighty Oregon team wins today. I think Farrell Brown might be the biggest winner in today's game.
Excellent point, Jill. Yep. And he loves competition. You got to love that in Farrell Brown. He's starting to return to form. Matt Lubeck said still everything is day-to-day with this guy right now. That traumatic knee injury, end of 2014, red shirts. Yeah, sitting on the couch watching his team across the country. play without him, and that's got to be tough. Glenn, was the longest you were ever out with an injury? Do you remember?
Maybe 2 weeks.
Yeah, you were a pretty healthy guy. You were lucky over 13 years in the league. Yeah, that, I think for a young guy, that's just killing you. And in a town like this where football is omnipresent.
The hardest thing is getting over your first injury, whatever that one is.
Psychologically
getting over it and realizing that you can rehab and you can get better. I've seen guys have devastating injuries and they never get over it. But I've seen the same injury in another guy and they do it, they do the rehab. And they're okay after that. Then the next time they're hurt, they realize I can rehab through this and come back. And so getting over the first one, no matter how severe it is huge. And for him, it's a great learning tool because now he knows. Now he knows what real injury is, unfortunately, but also he knows he's got the strength and the fortitude to come back from.
And I think that first hit, even though he just made the catch and was put down in his own tracks, I think that first hit had to feel great.
Oh, yeah.
First contact. You know, feeling a football player.
A lot of people ask me when I retired, you know, after so many years, what do you miss most? I don't miss hitting people as much as I miss getting hit. You actually miss getting hit. It's part of it. And you can't get that anywhere else in life but on the football field.
You can see right there on the jersey, you can see there's script in those lines. That is the school fight song from 1916, the Mighty Oregon March. And this is the kind of detail they have in this program. Not only these throwback jerseys, but then they sneak in the script of the fight song, Mighty Oregon March from 1916. Who's going to see that?
That is outstanding.
You're going to see that. Yeah.
Sing the story, Oregon. Love it. Go Ducks, go fight.
Well, you said it before. I mean, you're an 18-year-old high school senior from, well, I mean, look at Farrell Brown from across the country. He's from Ohio. And you come out here on your visit, you see these unbelievable facilities, people going crazy, little things like this, and you get all this cool gear. I mean, the locker room looks like you're on the bridge of the Star Trek Enterprise. It's just, I mean, it's mind-boggling when you first get here, especially if you're coming from a little high school program, didn't get a lot of attention. It's got to be intoxicating and tough to say no.
Oh, yeah.
That's the point, isn't it?
That's the point.
Don't say no. Come on out.
And like you just said, you know, he's from across the country. There was a time when you looked at Oregon and almost every kid was Oregon, Washington, California.
Yep.
And now they are like a USC, a UCLA, a Stanford. They can recruit anywhere in the country. They can walk in and they can get into a living room and talk to mom and dad because people across the country know Oregon.
I remember Mike Bellotti used to tell us he would go, you know, Texas, go across the country and say, you know, I'm from Oregon. And people would say, Oregon? Oregon State? You know, they weren't even sure which school. They don't do that anymore.
No, they don't.
The difference. Nice run right there. Ben Wong all the way down the sideline. And the crowd gets to practice that throaty cheer here at Autzen. Looked like he was going to score.
A little misdirection, just keeps off his legs churning.
Initial contact, and then he gets to the corner, and there's the speed. Protect the ball, knocked out just short of the cone. That looks nice, doesn't it?
It does if you're a Duck fan.
He had over 50 carries last year. His signature is the footwork and the balance between the tackles, and you just saw it. Reaches out, and Benoit is in. Touchdown. Home run. Remember, he had a 62-yard run at Arizona State. It was one of the biggest plays of the season. A lot of these guys would probably start on other teams, maybe in this conference. One for Freeman.
Quite possibly. You see the power. We saw it on the last one. He kept going right there. Hit well short of the line. Just drove himself through it. Extended the ball for the touchdown. I like the awareness. Where he's at.
Matt Wogan with the PAT. Six guys are back offensively on this team from the group that went 9-4. One of their biggest wins of last year, of course, came late in the season on the road at number 7 Stanford. November 14th, down on the farm. Helfrich and the boys were part. They were on a run at that point. I mean, that was when they put the 6 victories together. High-scoring first half. Vernon Adams ended up throwing for 2 touchdowns in that game. Stanford actually led the game at halftime. Second half, Oregon storms back, and Stanford's down by 8. Kevin Hogan to Greg Taborda. 4-yard touchdown. Stanford has to go for 2. The Oregon defense saves the day, 38-36. Oregon improved to 7-3 at that point. They ended up beating SC. They beat Oregon State in the Civil War, went to the Alamo Bowl, led 31-0. And that was the last high point for this program until today. Gave up all those points, lose to the Horned Frogs in triple overtime. Down for you on 3rd and short.
You like seeing him getting a chance? Get out here, get some touches in front of the fans.
And isn't that the point of a spring game? As you get, Royce Freeman was kind of complaining with a grin on his face that he didn't get any carries today, a couple of catches. But you get those guys out because there are guys fighting for jobs, guys trying to establish themselves and carve out their own spot in Eugene.
You got to find your guys, and you got to get those guys on the field.
It is the 20th Oregon spring game. Mighty Oregon leads the Oregon Webfoots 14-6 as we go to the fourth.
To think back, imagine trying to forecast all the things that happened until now. That's pretty interesting. So far, my favorite moment from my professional career is when I won the gold medal at the Olympics. On my victory lap, I had a bunch of friends who came to watch me. They were all in the front row on my victory lap. Like, I got to give everyone a hug. If you want to call it excellence, I've gotten the indoor world record in the heptathlon and the outdoor world record in the decathlon. I think record probably means more to me than, let's say, like winning the gold medal. To me, it feels like I'm contributing to a step of motivating people's ideas of what's possible. So my goal right now is to win the Olympic Games again and break the world record. It's pretty simple.
Coming up Monday on Sports Report, we'll tell you where our Pac-12 stars went in the NFL draft.
And we take a look into the past to reveal the Pac-12 All-Century Golf Team. For the next great golfer, we introduce you to Stanford star Maverick McNealy.
Congratulations to the 4 Pac-12 athletes drafted in the first round of the NFL draft. The Pac-12 is proud to call you our own. Congratulations and good luck.
Royce, 230 pounds. He is not a luxury automobile. He is a bullet train.
You're looking at one of the greatest running backs in college football right now.
Royce Freeman is the rarity in college football. He is a complete back, an absolute beast of a back.
He's got the speed. He can run you over, but he's also elusive.
They are more than pleased with what this guy has done throughout his Oregon career thus far.
Royce Freeman, last year, 350 yards through the air, 1,800 yards on the ground, 19 touchdowns, the number 4 back in the country. He looks healthy. He's bigger. And Mark Helfrich says he's better in a number of different categories. Good news in the sunshine in Eugene. And during that break, they pumped up the unofficial theme song, the University of Oregon Shout Animal House. Of course, the movie was shot here on campus, and the kids went nuts. 30,000 people on hand for the spring game. It's a testament to just how important football is in the Willamette Valley. Got out the green and gold. They put away the rain gear. It did rain yesterday in Eugene, but man, look at that blue sky today. And they were here early, 2 hours before kickoff. T-shirts. You know, usually the first part of the season here is really nice before the weather turns. There's Lacoste again, taking the short dump. It's across midfield. This kid's tough. Local kid, Albany. Worked with the scout team last year, 5'11", 210, redshirt senior. Puddle's okay. Puddle's been on a stretcher for most of the second half. Maybe pulled a hammy.
You know, mascot needs a spring game to get ready, too.
Don't we all? I saw Puddles was at one of the elementary schools this week. They had some student athletes go out and read to the local kids, and Puddle showed up. Yeah, this is a real college town, Eugene. And certainly the university is the heartbeat. We love you, Puddles. Of course, Puddles modeled after Donald Duck, the only time Disney has ever allowed anybody else to use a likeness of a Disney character. I think it's worked out well on both sides. Backside pressure. And that could have been ugly in the fall. Travis Johnson standing there and holding on to it. Got to rely on that left tackle, but coming off the edge is Paris Bostic.
It's an extra man. And Bostic's looking inside, so
Bostic could have crushed him.
Yeah,
if it were live. And he puts his hands up. I know I'm not supposed to touch the quarterback. Look, they only went live twice in the spring. They're only going to go live once in the fall. And Helfrich told us, we're not going live at all during season. Not going to happen. Travis Johnson, the redshirt freshman from Southern California. Redshirted last year. Got a man open for a touchdown. Darren Carrington, touchdown for the Webfoots. So is that good news for the offense or bad news for the secondary?
Well, what you have there is it's two split teams, so it's the ability for the coaches to say, it doesn't matter. It's great that the ball was delivered. It's great that your quarterback, Travis Johnson, sees him, gets rid of the ball before pressure hits him, kind of. Might have actually been a sack, but they let it get away. Hey, and that's your starter, Carrington, one of the few starters returning, making that play for you. So I don't think you look at it in terms of good or bad. You look at it in terms of execution.
Going to go for it. Go for two here. Trips right. Five receivers, empty backfield. Johnson looks back over. They want to see how he handles signals and works the play clock. Reset now. I like to use the slot guy in this spot, but they're going to keep it on the ground. Lacoste battles his way near the goal line. Give it to him. You bet. 2 points. That offensive line is going to get a lot of attention this year. Jake Hansen, probably the redshirt freshman at center. Tyrell Crosby's back. Cameron Hunt, but not necessarily in their same spots.
Well, the thing with offensive line, you know, when you say not necessarily in the same spots, it's getting five guys that can play together. It's not necessarily are they five best guys. It's the five best guys that play together.
Yeah, chemistry.
And it's really a different animal. I always like to say, you know, it was interesting being at big awards. You know, you're an offensive lineman, you get some award. You know, even like quarterbacks, running backs, the defense, they talk about the offensive line. They talk about individuals at every other position.
That's a great point.
But they talk about the O-line. The O-line is not made up of individuals. I love that.
It's a club.
That's right.
Yeah.
So that's a point of pride for offensive linemen, is that none of you stick out. There is no guy. You want them all to be good. You want to be known as a group. You want to move as a herd. And it's finding guys that can do that on the field, be your guys. That's what they have to kind of put together through the going into the fall.
And maybe spring's as important for this group as it is for any other part of this team. Greatwood likes to mix and match in the spring. We were just talking about the chemistry with this offensive line. The defensive line dominated the first five or six practices, and then that gap started to close. The offensive line caught up. Remember, again, they lose the center, Matt Hegarty. They lose the whole left side, so Hanson, Crosby, Hunt. There's going to be other guys. Doug Brenner, redshirt junior from Portland. He should be in the mix at one of the guard spots. Jacob Capra, primarily a guard, but he's seen some action at right tackle in the scrimmages. Elijah George, I mean, gone over to the defensive side, so he's not available. Jake Pisarczyk, returning veteran. He's going to get some looks at guard. Joe Pisarczyk. You got a guy coming in from Dayton in the fall, Zach Morgan, a graduate transfer who might be a guy that brings them experience, because they're going to have some kids. They're going to have some rookies up there and some guys with light experience.
Yeah, and it's easy to play offensive line if you're on a team that's always ahead. But when you get in competitive situations and the crowd's going and it gets a little nervous, young guys, that's when they start to have problems. They start to fail a little bit. So you want that maturity to hold them together. It'll be interesting what they do. It'll be interesting to see how they perform. But knowing Greatwood, knowing what they're looking for, you know, I think they'll be fine. And as far as being behind the defense is always ahead when you start in the, because they react. So they, not with a one gap where they're just attacking, offensive line is trying to coordinate groups and figure out who they are. They're gonna get defeated most of the time.
But, Chase Madey with that catch.
But they can become a strength, and they will become a strength. With, if it's not early in the season, by the end of the season, I don't know that we'll be talking about the offensive line as much. And if we are, they won't be a very good team.
Yeah. Clint, the average fan, of course, watches the quarterback. Your eye goes to the ball. You understand more about that part of the field.
Hard to make it, yeah. But what it is they're setting their line. And what I say that, they're finding the Mike backer so that they know their count. So
when I see a
running play, they know, all right, they know how many they have play size. If it's a pass, they're identifying Mike so that lets the quarterback and running back know who they have. And so then, once that happens, then your other offensive linemen, they come into play because now they have to identify others outside they're responsible for and have a call ready that will allow them to pick up the majority of whoever comes.
To hang together even off the field. Offensive linemen, they go to eat together because it's easier.
Offensive linemen do everything together. And they are as tight a group as you'll ever find.
I've walked into restaurants before and seen a pile of ribs on a table.
Yeah.
Looks like a dinosaur fossil. It's offensive linemen. Oh, ball thrown high and late and picked off. It's Ty Griffin with a snag.
Yeah, ball was thrown upfield rather than out. It was a deep out and the ball went to the back receiver and was high, as you said. And that's just youth at quarterback.
Ty Griffin from Powder Springs Jr. 6 foot, he needed every inch here. That's Terry Wilson, the freshman quarterback. You know, Helfrich said that Wilson is actually the most natural fit for this system. We're talking with coach. But the problem, of course, for Terry Wilson, he's 18 years old. And he just got here. He's still trying to find out where the bathroom is.
Yeah.
Well, Mark Helfrich said before the game might be a little ragged, but he's going to give these folks a pretty good show. He's down on the field with Jill.
Thank you so much, Coach. The assessment so far of today, how's it been for you?
A little ragged, a little back and forth. Had a bunch of opportunities in the first half to make some plays offensively. Had a few drops, a couple penalties, too many here and there, but overall, competing hard and playing hard.
You look at Travis Johnson, and one of the things that we've heard about him is consistency. You see an interception, but then a nice touchdown from him as well.
This is not good. Nothing good can result out of this. All right, there we go.
Break that down for us. What was that?
It was a lot of man with the ball in his hand right there. Yeah.
Consistency from the quarterbacks this spring. I know that's one of the things that you said. You can't have a starter name because they just haven't been consistent enough. So what can they do to make those strides?
Just make routine plays. You know, we have so many guys in our offense, and there are a ton of just routine decisions to be made, routine plays to be made. And the guy that's really the most consistent in that, the most accurate in that, is going to win the job.
Now, Farrell Brown was out there. I know he said it was his goal to play in this spring game. He hasn't been out here since November of 2014. What does it mean to have a guy like that back out there? And a touchdown as well.
It's really good. Newsflash. Yeah, it's it's great to have him out here. And he was very limited today. We just had him go a quarter, along with, you've seen a few of the other guys, Royce and Charles and the rest of the guys that were suspended after the first quarter.
All right, this is getting chaotic. I'll let you go celebrate with a touchdown now.
All right, thanks a lot.
He's got the right attitude for the spring game. And again, Dylan Mitchell makes a pretty good catch here against coverage.
Yeah, if one guy has stood out above all else, yeah. How about Mitchell? The ball's not thrown well, but he adjusts and does an incredible job of beating the defender to the ball.
No wonder Prukop keeps throwing to this kid. This ball should have been picked. Ends up as a touchdown.
Yeah, there's a name we might be talking about. Right there.
They've been talking about him every day in practice. I'm checking the message boards, and everybody's saying, wow, I keep seeing Dylan Mitchell's name pop up, and the word everybody uses is playmaker. Gets overused in football. We've seen him make two big plays already today. And by the way, that offensive lineman, there he is, big number 73, Tyrell Crosby, took that backwards pass and rolled, and Helfrich said, oh, this isn't good. I'm telling you. 6'5", 310 in the open field. Is there anything more beautiful in the game of football?
Not at all. Not at all.
That's awesome.
Big fella gets a chance to get fed. That's the best part.
All right, this is what it looked like from Jill's point of view down on the field.
She better run.
Yeah, you don't want him rolling up on you. Look, it took 11 guys to knock him out of bounds. Good times. Yeah, it might be the last time he sees the football until the banquet. The cost. Cost is going to be exhausted.
He's getting a full workout, and there's big Tyler Crosby. One of the few coming back on the O-line. One of the only starters returning.
Well, he was the right tackle last year. They're mm-hmm. talking about flipping him, putting on that left side, because obviously that's the most important position to protect the quarterback on that offensive line is that left tackle. I mean, everybody has their assignments, but, you know, with Prukop in there right now as the guy, if you don't protect your quarterback, it's going to change the season. We saw it last year. Vernon Adams missed those three games. So a lot of pressure on him if he's going to line up a left tackle.
I'm not sure of his fashion sense wearing kind of a half shirt there. But
not a good look? It's not slimming?
Vertical stripes, Tyler. Vertical stripes.
And Steve Greywood right there, still coaching him up. Oh, almost a pick and a prance. Pretty good read. Paris Bostic again. We already saw him come off the edge, and he could have crushed the quarterback. It's a name people might want to highlight on their roster. Jump this route. Just over 3 minutes to play. Bostic, by the way, is from Tampa. But before he came here, he was playing at Santa Monica Junior College on the west side of L.A. I love talking to these guys about their circuitous routes, how they end up. I mean, you start in Florida, you play J.C. Ball in Southern California, and then you end up on the big stage at Autzen. Big run there for Travis Johnson. And it brings me back to you because you went the same way. You went the J.C. route. You came to this game late and found instant success. How did it happen?
Well, great coaches. Great coaches. You know, I didn't play in high school. I was 20 years old when I walked on, and I happened to be at a JC in Huntington Beach, where I'm from. And I'm not a believer in luck. I'm a believer in actions. And so I made a mistake. The first coach I talked to was an offensive line coach. I should have talked to a tight ends coach. Maybe a defensive ends coach. That's why I might have been that, you know. And unfortunately, I talked to an offensive line coach. So I became an offensive lineman. I had great coaching that taught me the game from the outside in. Junior college football is an incredible level of football. It's really competitive in most leagues. And as evidenced by every D1 program has JC players on it.
Yep.
Kids go there for a variety of reasons. It's changed since I was in school. But, you know, when I was in school, a lot of kids already had scholarships. They were just trying to get better scholarships back then, because you don't know, there were 125 scholarships on most of your teams. There's a lot more kids on a team. Now with the 85 limit, much harsher academic standards, it's changed a little bit, but the quality is incredible. Quality of football play at JC. You know, you look at a guy like Cam Newton, JC football player. Aaron Rodgers, another JC player.
That's right. Before he went to Cal, sure.
Yeah, and it's I think a lot of parents look at it like it's, you know, you failed because you didn't get a D1 scholarship. But remember, young men mature at a very different rate than women do. And a lot of guys at 18 are not the same as they're going to be at 22.
Mature.
I still like everything I liked when I was 12. It hadn't changed. I like other things, but I still like those things.
Less than a minute to go. We actually have a game here. As Mighty Oregon on defense protecting that 7-point lead. I think this only matters for the players. I would have to figure that they had something going on. Maybe just food. Not going to be any overtime, so if they score, they'd probably go for two and try to win it. And of the 30,000, I would guess that 25,000 are still in the bowl. You know, this stadium, I think, looks best when it's cold and a little rainy and it's packed.
It never rains at Autzen Stadium, don't you know that?
But it never rains here. That's what they say. It looks pretty good in the sunshine, too, doesn't it? Hey, what happened to that LED field I heard so much about on April 1st?
On April 1st.
Yeah. Fake to Lacoste. Throw back to Lacoste, looking for the equalizer.
I think he got the first down.
Got a scrum to the three. Yeah, he's right at the stick.
That'll stop the clock. Let him get ready to go. Like this kid.
I do too. You got to have one of those guys on your team, right?
Every team has that guy. The walk-on fullback or the tough guy fullback.
Made a good catch. Well, behind him at the knees, and he holds on to it.
Great job.
Can't give it to Freeman every time. Jared Lacoste.
And
Albany, Oregon.
Maybe opening some eyes, giving himself a chance.
Scout team guy last year.
That shows you his passion and dedication. When he was a scout team player, ran scout team.
That's a long way from Autzen Stadium being on the scout team.
That's right.
Band's here. The kids have come out. Didn't bring their front teeth yet, but they will. Those are coming. Hang in there, brother. 21-14. Chance to tie here. Or win it. Lacoste to the one before he's turned back. Offensive line talking to each other. Looked like that was Jake Hansen at center. And he's supposed to be at center. In the fall, they keep it. Travis Johnson now makes it a one-point game with 32 seconds to go. And the clock finally stops here. Remember, running clock in the second half, so just enough time. That's a good fake. Walks in untouched. Go for two, or the coaches say, no, let's kick it. Everybody goes home even. David Yost says, yeah, my quarterbacks can keep it every now and then.
And the defense is like, wait a minute. We can't touch him.
Yeah, we're not allowed to tackle
him. That's a little unfair.
How are we supposed to keep him out of the end zone? They're going to go for two here and try to win it. Anything but the fade.
Let's see if they go to Lacoste. They've kind of found ways to get him involved.
We got a Johnny Munt, the tight end. He's had a good day. It's Lacoste. Never got close. And it looks like Mighty Oregon is going to hold on to win it. And the celebration begins.
That guy right there, Moloata, I thought he had a big day as well. Good wrap-up tackle. They don't have to go live. They know how to tackle.
Their defense has got a lot of ground to make up, but this is a different group. They gave up 38 points a game last year, worst in the Pac-12. 485 yards of total defense, worst in the Pac-12. So it's all on Brady Hoke, isn't it?
Well, they certainly brought him in to make a difference. And
they're only returning four
interesting
guys
to see.
From that defense, yeah. And he had that clean slate, man. Etch-a-sketch. Just shake it. Start over. I don't know anybody. Prove it to me. And there's a couple of guys he's called out that said, look, you know, now I've been here long enough. I know you were a starter last year, but I haven't seen it. You got to prove it. You got to show it to me.
How about that? You're up by one, and you go to a flea flicker trying to get yourself another score. I love it. But there's what you reference.
Yeah, not pretty rankings, Sam. Yeah. And certainly in this conference, because it's a pass-heavy conference, the numbers are going to be inflated, but that's the direction of a lot of college football.
Well, that's the whole thing. You know, like all the records that were set offensively last year, numbers don't matter in football. They change the rules all the time, and that facilitates a difference in the numbers all the time. There are no sacred numbers in football. Nobody knows how many yards Emmitt Smith had, and he leads the league in rushing. But I can still tell you how many home runs Babe Ruth has.
714. Sadahara, 758.
There you go.
All right, so Mighty Oregon holds on to beat the Webfoots 21-20. We're coming back to wrap things up in Eugene.